Today, I'm super excited to welcome my friend and our longtime painter master, Cher Pendarvis. And you probably already know quite a bit about Cher because she's an extremely talented artist, and she's also the author of the Painter Wow books and the Photoshop and Painter Artist Tablet book. So we happen to work hand in hand with Cher as a trusted advisor for the Corel Painter team. And she really does so much to help us develop the future versions of the product. So I just want to give a huge thanks to Cher. Thank you so much for your support. And then today, she's going to be taking you through an exploration of brush expression with a specific focus on learning tips on how to optimize your experience when using your Wacom grip and your art pens during the session. So this will be very exciting, and I can't wait to learn a little bit from Cher here today. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn it over to you, Cher.
Thank you very much, Tanya. I'm really excited to be here today, and it's been a pleasure working with Painter for so many years, more than 20 years, and also using a Wacom tablet since even before the first ones were released over 20 years ago. What we have here are my Painter Wow book and my Photoshop and Painter Artist Tablet book covers, and the imagery on these covers was painted in Painter. So I wanted to show you another painting. This was inspired by a trip my husband Steve and I took to go to Australia. And I wanted to point out the brushwork on the landscape there, Lennox Head, and then also in the clouds. Now, this type of brushwork would not be possible without Painter and the Wacom tablet. In this particular painting, I used various oil brushes, including some of the real oils and then also bristle oils, and also the Wacom grip pen and the Wacom art pen. So if I zoom into this, this is quite a large file, and if I zoom into this, you can see some of the detail with the brush marks. Again, this would not be possible on the computer without Painter and the Wacom tablet and pens. Now I want to bring up the Wacom panel. Now I took a screenshot of this, and it shows the functions, the touch, the grip pen, and the art pen. So you can do customization for either of your pens, for individual applications, or for all applications as I have chosen here. And you'll see I have my tip feel set a little bit on the soft side. That means I don't have to press as hard, you know, when I'm making a stroke. Okay. Also very important is the brush tracking in Painter, and I'm going to take my grip pen and I'm just going to make a stroke right here. Now I pressed light and heavy and then a little bit lighter right here. I tend to like my pressure scale and my pressure power all the way up. So this gives me a good variety between a lighter pressure and a heavier pressure. I'm going to bring up another little file here. What you see right here, this stroke was made with the grip pen, this stroke was made with the art pen. This is the worn oil pastel. This is the square grainy pastel, and again, the grip pen and the art pen. And I'm going to make some of these strokes too to actually demonstrate it for you. What we have down here is the custom bristle spray oils, which I'm going to show you how to build later. And this one right here is the soft flat oils. Okay, with the grip pen, now I'm going to just move this little panel here so that I can bring my Painter forward and open a new file. right now I'm using the grip pen. And let's just take a moment and look at the interface that we have here. Here we have the brush selector, the very top. We have the property bar, which is sensitive to the tool that you have chosen here, and the brush tool is chosen. One of my favorite features in Painter X3 is the brush search. One of my other favorite features in Painter X3 is the advanced brush controls. So the Worn Oil Pastel is one of the brushes that I made when I helped review the Wacom Art Pen during its development. I worked with Wacom. Also, I was very honored to build some of the first brushes for the Art Pen for Corel and for Wacom. So let's just bring up the brush search right here. If you want to know what brushes will work with rotation, if you have your Art Pen, you can just type in rotation right here and hit enter, and it will search for brushes that have rotation. You see I have quite, you know, some custom brushes here, and then I also have some of the brushes that we're going to be demonstrating in this session. So this is really helpful. The first brush that we're going to demonstrate is the Worn Oil Pastel. Now, the grip pen is sensitive to bearing, which is the direction that you point the brush or point the pen, and also tilt and pressure. If we look into our brush expressions right here on the opacity panel, you'll see none, velocity, which is how fast you drag your pen across your canvas, direction. Expression is if you're dragging it horizontally or vertically. Pressure is how hard you press onto your canvas, onto your tablet. Wheel, if you have an airbrush stylus, there's a wheel at the top, just like a traditional airbrush. And you can actually set up to control with the wheel. Tilt is something that's very useful for the grip pen. Now, if you draw a stroke and hold your pen vertical, the way most of the brushes are set up, your stroke might be narrower, and as you lean or tilt your pen over, you're going to see a broader stroke. Bearing is the direction that you have your pen pointed at. Rotation would be like a barrel roll, and I'm going to be demonstrating some of that with a couple of these brushes. The Art Pen is unique in being able to pick up the barrel roll. The Grip Pen, tilt and bearing are going to be two of the choices that you're going to want to think about, as well as pressure. Source is if you have a clone source connected to your document, or the current pattern, and random is exactly as it says. If you have your opacity set to random, then it would be randomly changing as you paint. Right now we have opacity set to pressure. If we look over here in the advanced brush controls, you'll see Worn Oil Pastel was made to make it as an art pen brush, but because of the rotation right here. And the squeeze is set to 50%. And you see, if you look at the dab preview right here, you'll see that it was more of a roundish oval, but it's been squeezed to 50%, which means as you draw vertically and horizontally, you're going to get a narrow stroke or a wider stroke. Now, the angle is 90. the angle can, by default, the angle can be changed, and you'll see it change here in the dab preview. And rotation, which again is picked up with the art pen. So I'm just going to make a stroke here with the grip pen, and then I'm going to switch to my art pen, and we'll see a little bit different stroke. Now, as I make this stroke, I'm going to be rolling my pen in my hand. See this narrower area right here as the pen rotates? I'm rotating it the way that I would rotate barrel roll. Okay. Next we're going to demonstrate the square grainy pastel. And I've made a little custom palette here. Here we have a grainier brush. My pen is going to remember the last brush I chose, so I'm going to click over here to make sure Painter's remembering that I want to change brushes. And see the barrel roll that we have here, see the difference between these two strokes. Next we'll demonstrate the soft flat oils. And I'm going to switch to my art pen. And you see the advanced brush controls changes because when I change brushes, because it's bringing up the panels that are active for this. Now those of you that are interested in building your own brushes, the advanced brush controls is going to be a great jumping off place for you to get more familiar with the brush control panels in Painter. Now I have the art pen, and you see as I rolled it, did the barrel roll in my hand, you'll see the nice finesse in this stroke right here compared to the grip pen, which is still nice, but this is a lot more flourish with it. And that's the type of brushing that I was doing in the clouds that you saw in the seascape earlier. Now I'm just going to clear this. We're going to demonstrate a calligraphy pen. Now this is one of my favorites. And there we go. The grainy calligraphy. Right now I've got the grip pen and I have my button pointed up on my pen. Okay, that's with the grip pen. Now we're going to switch to the art pen. And just as a calligrapher might with a traditional pen, I'm rolling, as I come down here, I'm slightly rolling my pen as I come up to here. Slightly rolling my pen. With the art pen. Again, with the art pen. Slightly rolling. Now I've made a custom brush which I wanted to demonstrate how it was made, but first I want to demonstrate the brush. So I'm going to make a few marks. Now you'll see here on my custom bristle spray, I'm using the grip pin and I've tilted my pen. Now if I hold my pen vertically, like I mentioned earlier, my stroke is going to be narrower and denser. You see the way the bristle spray works, it's almost as if it's spraying these bristles out this way, so it's broader. Okay. Now I'm going to switch to my art pen, choose this custom brush again. And I have the button on my pen up. And I've gently rolled it. Now I have this brush set up so that the bristles are going to randomize according to the rotation. Now I'm going to make, I'm holding my pen straight up. Whoops, wait a second here. There we go. There we go. So see, I've held my pen fairly vertically, but you see a little bit more randomization up in here where that I've built into the brush. One more stroke with the art pen. And I'm rolling it in my hand. There we go. Okay, I'd like to go through the stages or steps of making this brush. Okay, for this particular brush, this particular brush, I started with a very simple brush, and I'm going to go over here to the pens, and I'm going to get the pen, one pixel pen, and I'm going to copy this brush to my custom brush category that I already have built down here. Okay, now I'm going to navigate. I'm clicking here to open the brush selector. And again, I'm going to navigate down to my shares custom brushes. And I just wanted to tell you how easy it is to make your own custom brush category. You can go up to brushes and choose new brush category. Name your category and it will store it in your current brush library. Or you can go to this little button here on the Brush Painter Brush Library and click here, and you'll see new brush category. Now, I recommend making your own custom brush category and backing it up just in case you want to reset Painter to its defaults. It's possible that you could lose your custom brushes if you leave them within the standard brush categories within Painter. So I'm going to choose this one pixel pen. And I'm going to save variant. And I'm going to rename my little pen. And I'm going to call it and see it goes right into my custom brush category. Now I'm going to navigate to my brush. And I'm going to clear this canvas right now. Get my pen. And you'll see, there we go, it reverted. Painter and the tablet remembered that I had the other brush chosen earlier. So when I picked up my grip pen, it shows that brush. So I'm just going to delete this stroke. Going to see the one pixel pen. Now to change my dab type, I go to the general panel of brush controls. And for those of you that aren't really familiar with the brush controls, I just want to show you right now how to open the brush controls. You choose Window from the menu at the top and choose General. You see I have them all open right now, all ready to go. But you want to choose Window, Brush Control Panels, General. Okay. And I'm going to change my dab type to Bristle Spray. And I'm going to increase my size to about 30. Now what it gives me right away is quite a large feature, and I wanted to talk about that. Now the feature is actually how tightly the bristles within the brush are bundled. Now if you want something that's a really dry brush look, you know, you might want something that is as broad as this or as loose as this. So I'm going to reduce this to between 2 and 3, and you see how that tightens it. Let's bring it down to like 2. You can type within these as well. And I'm tilting my brush over if I draw straight up and down. It's like so. Okay. Now the next thing we're going to do is we're going to change our opacity to pressure. So if I paint really light, I have a lighter stroke. Paint heavy, I have a heavier stroke. Now I'm going to go into the size panel, and you can do it here on your advanced brush controls, or you can do it over here. I'm going to change my size expression to pressure. And right here we have the size of our brush, which is what you see here in the brush dab preview window. I'm going to make my min size right about 25. And if I click right here, you'll see this is the min size and this is the maximum size. So now when I paint, my brush is going to go from light to heavy. Now I'm just going to clear this. We could actually open this our feature up a little bit. And another note about the feature is going to affect the performance of your brush. So you need to find a sweet spot between having it real loose and look more like a dry brush like we looked at earlier, or real tight if you want it to be smooth. So I think opening it up to maybe 2.6, I'd see a little bit more bristle marks. There we go. And it performs a little bit faster. So to add an art pen feature into this brush, I use the stroke jitter that's down here, and I used about 0.06, and then I changed this to rotation, so that when we rotate the brush, it's going to, and I'm going to choose my art pen now, when we rotate the brush, you see that little bit of randomness in the hairs. Now that is a very natural look, and that's what we want. Let's do something really dramatic and turn it way up. See what you get. A real furry brush. Yeah. So back down. That's kind of neat there, and a little bit more. And you can also type in this. So I'm using my art pen and you can see the little bit of natural randomness in. Now, when I'm happy with my brush, or even as I'm going along the way, you can always set the default variant for your custom brush. So brushes, set default variant. So now I've created a new default for my brush.
Cher?
Yes.
Would this be an okay time to take just a couple questions?
Yes, of course.
Okay. And I should know this, but I can't remember for sure if you can use the shift key. Do you hold the shift key when you want to create straight lines? Do you happen to?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes. You can use the, right now I'm using, if you look at the very top here in the property bar, when you have the brush chosen, you'll see the to reset tool, then you'll see freehand strokes, straight strokes. Mm-hmm. So if I hold down the shift key, see, I can draw straight.
Okay, perfect. Too. Thank you for coming.
Sure, and of course.
Karen had a question. She does both traditional and digital work in acrylics, pastel, oils. And what she really enjoys with traditional oils is a less bristly look. She thinks that her in Painter, the brushes that she's been trying in the oils category are too bristly for her. So I wonder if you can recommend a brush that's not so bristly and that does some really nice blending.
Oh, okay. Well, let me see. That's
a loaded
great question. I had a wild thought right then. Oh, well, we could change this brush to do that right now. But
right.
The best thing is to go to our brush library and into the oils. And let's see. Has she experimented with the brushes with the artist oils capabilities? Now this one has some clumpiness built into it, but it does blend really nice. Just a moment here.
She said a little bit. I think it's still not exactly what she's going for.
Okay.
Even, you know, it would be interesting because I know that you can clump the bristles together.
The bristly ones, yeah.
Yeah, make them less prominent.
The fine enamel. Yes, there are ways to turn on the blending by coming in here and lowering the reset. See, I have right now the fine camel. So I lowered the resaturation in the well panel. So to do that, Karen, you would open your brush controls and then go to the well panel. I have advanced brush controls open, so it was easy for me to go right there.
Mm-hmm.
Let me just shoot on this one too. Whoop. There's my well panel. There. So as you look down your brush controls, you'll see your well panel. And then you can increase the bleed and then invert your bleed expression. So that way, I use a little bit different color, you can actually blend, see, right here?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So if you're pressing really light, then you can blend it.
Okay, great. Thanks, Cher.
Yeah, sure. And then if you look in the oils category, and if you look at Real Oil Smeary, now this one has more bristles here, but you can reduce the feature up here, bristle density, the feature. You can reduce that a little bit. If you reduce it a lot, it's going to make your brush a lot slower. But, you know, you can play with that.
Okay, she wants me to tell you thank you, and she's going to play a little bit more.
Great. And try out all of the oils brushes, because there are some there that will do that. And then now that you know how to control your feature, that's going to help you a lot. Thank you for your great question, Karen. Did you have another question?
Well, it was relating to the original question. It was when you had the painting that we can still see there in there.
Right.
Bob was wondering what size the painting is.
Oh, okay. It's just under 4,000 pixels.
Okay. And do you have a particular size and resolution that you work at in Painter, or does it depend on the end result and where it's going to end up?
It actually does depend on the end result, because mm-hmm. if I'm doing something for screen display, I'm going to be using 72 pixels per inch, and I'm going to create it two or three times the size that I'm actually going to be showing it on screen, so that I could zoom into it. If I'm creating an illustration to be printed using offset printing, I'm going, depending on how large the dimensions need to be, you know, for if it's for an advertisement or for a magazine cover or something like that, I'm going to find out the dimensions that the art director needs. And I'm going to start a file in those dimensions. And, you know, if Painter and my hardware will handle it, then I'll create it at 300 pixels per inch, you know, so.
Right.
Let me just show here. See, right now I have those little files I was bringing up were 800 by 600 at 72. Now, I'd experiment with doing this with my width and height with inches, say if it was 8 plus and 11 plus here for width, and then make this 300 right here in pixels per inch. Now, if my machine wouldn't handle that, then I would use 150 while I got my underpainting, you know, because usually in the underpainting stage and like up to about midway through, I like to paint very loosely and quickly, kind of like what you see here in the sky. And then, but if my machine is lagging with a big file at 300 pixels per inch, then I'll do a test first with the brushes I want to use. Then if it is lagging, then I'll do it at 150 right here, pixels per inch, through just past my underpainting stage. And then when I want to do my fine details and fine texture and things like that, then I'll save a copy of my file and I'll res it up to 300 to do the final painting.
Okay, interesting.
That's for offset printing. Now, if I'm printing with an atelier or on my professional inkjet printer at my studio, then I would usually set up my file at 150.
Okay.
Because it takes a different resolution going to your inkjet printer or an atelier inkjet printer than it does going to offset printing.
Okay, thanks so much.
You're very welcome.
Great answer. And we're good to go with the questions now.
Did you say there are more questions?
Nope. You addressed every one of them.
Okay, thanks. I wanted to show a couple of other paintings. This one you see, it's very free, and this one was created with the grip pen and some of the smoother oil brushes and also the blenders. The floating orchid too, I have it zoomed in to 100% so that you could see the texturing. With this one, I used both the grip pen and the arc pen and the pastels brushes and oil pastel brushes in Painter. And I'll just zoom out. It's still in process. And then I was thinking, about what other changes that we could do to the brush that we were working with before, the custom bristle spray oils. If we wanted to make this brush a little bit smoother, but still have these bristles come out when we roll our pen, we could reduce our feature to 2.2. And then back to the well panel, and we could reduce our resaturation really low. Actually, if we reduce it to zero, it's going to turn it into a blender. But I still want it to give me a little bit of the medium flowing through the pen, so I'm going to have it down about just under 20%. And then I'm going to go down here to the bleed, and I'm going to increase my bleed really high and choose another color. And you see that I'm able to pull that paint right there. Now this might be something that Karen might like, because this is quite smooth. Thanks for inspiring me, Karen. And then now we're going to change this to pressure, the bleed expression to pressure.
I really like that brush.
Thanks. And then if we come in here to, it's going to invert. So it's going to allow us to move that pink without applying blue. But if I press hard, I'm going to paint blue. Hmm. Yeah, so we like that. We can save this as a smeary version of what we were doing. I'm just going to put an S after it for smeary. Yeah. Did we have more questions?
Carrie was wondering if you've done giclée printing.
Oh, yes. I have done giclée printing, and I usually work through an atelier.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I like to do mixed media with my prints sometimes. Sometimes I'll have a vision that I want to do my underpainting in Painter, and I want to paint over a print with other media. It could be acrylic, or it could be pastels. So, or it could be oils. So if you do your giclée print on canvas, then golden has a really nice gel that you can paint over it to protect the print. And then when that's dry, then you can paint over it either with oils or with acrylics, whichever is your preference. So that way you're using your Painter painting, you know, where you've blocked in your composition and so on, as kind of a base. And then if you have a print on paper you're working with, pastels and oil pastels work really nice, you know, if you want to use other media with your Painter artwork.
Yeah, it seems that, you know, printing and then using traditional media on top of the print is becoming very popular.
Yes, and you're creating a one-of-a-kind. So Painter is so nice because it's so fluid, and it allows you to sketch in your composition. You know, you can look at multiple references, or if you're into doing collage, you know, you can bring in your multiple references and work with them, you know, mm-hmm. as layers and so on, move them around in your image. This particular one that we have right here with the orchid, I blocked in the background, and then I painted my orchid in another file, and I actually brought it in. Then I merged it with the canvas and painted over the entire thing. So Painter allows you to have that flexibility. And then when you have your composition the way that you want it and you do a print, sometimes it's fun to work over it with other media. For me, sometimes I want to realize my complete composition within Painter. And other times, like I said before, I've got the vision of, you know, I want to work over this with pastel, or I want to work over this with oils.
There's a few questions that popped in here now. And
great.
Betty is wondering if you could tell us the specific gold product that you use. She's been using a varnish from Breathing Color that she feels is good, but it's tough to apply.
Okay, it's a golden varnish, and it's a glossy. And you mix it with water.
Okay, great.
Yes.
She
can message me later, and I could tell her the percentage and the exact product, but I don't have it sitting on my desk. It's out in my studio with the easel.
Okay, terrific. Okay. It's Betty Miner.
Hi, Betty.
That asked the question.
Thank you.
And Wardy is wondering if you enter any art competitions, and if so, do you enter your paintings as mixed media, or how do you describe them if they are a mix between digital and traditional?
Well, hi, Wardy. Thank you for your great question. Well, if it's digital, completely digital, then I will say that it's an archival inkjet print, and it's a digital painting. Because with something like this, you know, that I've painted completely from scratch, I don't describe it as photography because it's not photography. If someone is working with photography, they might want to say that it's a painted photograph. It depends on where the artist is coming from, if they're coming from using photography or if they're coming from direct painting. You know, starting with sketches, kind of more like I usually work.
Right.
So if it's a mixed media, then I would say it's a mixed media.
Yeah. Okay.
And then it's a one of a kind. And if I'm doing a digital edition that is, say, several pieces that are going to be printed in the same way that are a digital painting that's done in Painter, or, you know, if you're a photography-based artist and you have an edition of a collage that you've done, I recommend keeping good records of your editions, and usually you get a better value if you have smaller editions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That makes a lot of sense.
And then Wardy, I'm sorry, your question. If I have part of my underpainting done in Painter, and then if I've worked pastel over the top, then I call it a mixed media. And again, if it's just digital, then I'll say it's a digital painting, and it's an archival inkjet print. And I had work juried into a few shows recently, one with our local Point Loma artist group, and that was a pastel on paper, so that didn't have a digital element in it, but with our Museum of Art Artist Guild here in San Diego, they accept digital work as well as traditional painting, photography, sculpture. And with that one, my underpainting was done in Painter. I actually did sketches out in the field with my pastels, you know, and also on my iPad, and then I took those references to my studio and painted, and that's actually this one right here. Let me go to this. The cover of my artist tablet book, so there were multiple references for this cover. The main painting was painted in Painter digitally with my Wacom tablet, and then I had a print made, and then I worked over my print with a lot of pastel, the one that's actually in the art show. So that one is a mixed media.
That is one of my favorite paintings. I love that one.
Thank you.
So beautiful.
Thank you. That's a view that at a park nearby, a few miles away.
It must be nice to have that view.
It's dear to our heart.
Yeah. I don't get that in the city of Chicago. I guess I can if I go down to the lake, but... okay,
and
so there's
Wardy,
one.
I think Wardy is in Australia, and he would recognize this headland because we were very fortunate about 9 years ago to visit Lennox Head and stay there for a few weeks. So I sat out on the deck behind and did watercolors, and then when I came home, I had watercolors and drawings, and I painted this homage to Lennox. In Painter.
And Wardy says, surf's up.
Wardy, catch one for me, please. Thank you for coming.
Okay, I have one more question from Denise. And she's wondering, do you typically work on the background of the painting first, or are you separating the main subject from the background, and particularly if you're working from a photograph?
That's a really good question. It changes according to the piece. With this particular piece, you see the background's not finished yet, but I did work on block in the background first. And like I said, I started the orchid in another file. And I selected it and I brought it in. So this was actually layers. You know, this particular file's flattened because I'm painting over the whole thing at this point. But usually I'll work from background to foreground. And I want to keep things really loose. Let me go. Like with this. The sky was much more loose and messy when earlier in the painting. And then I came back in and I added more detail with the clouds and so on. So one thing I remember about Australia is the amazing clouds and the amazing magenta sunsets and sunrises. The colors were much more vivid than we have in Southern California. So yeah, in this particular one, the foreground is very loose because I wanted the eye to go to the headland and to the clouds. But typically I would work from the background to the foreground. I would work from loose, and then tighten it down towards being finished. Did we have any other questions related to the art pen and the grip pen and Painter?
So Denise has one more question, and that is, do you like the art pen with the Intuos 5?
Oh, yes, I love it. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. It works fantastic with the Intuos 5 and the Intuos Pro. I highly recommend it.
Okay, and Wardy is wondering, any tips on nibs to use in the pens? Do you have any tips?
Oh my goodness. Oh yes. Depending on the type of feel that you like, you know, there's the one that's almost like a felt marker, and then there's the one that's a little bit more smooth. Let me look at my nibs here. Yes. So there's one that actually, as you drag your stylus on your pad, you can hear a little sound just as if you were working on, or similar to working on paper. And then there are a couple others that are much smoother. And then I just wanted to give another tip that if you open your holder that came with your stylus for the recent Wacom tablets, like the Intuos 5 and the Intuos Pro, you'll see a selection of nibs. So I wish that I could actually show that to you right now, but all you have to do, you'll see that the base and the top of your pen holder will come apart if you twist it. And that's where your nibs are located.
Okay. There was also a question as to whether or not you have a custom workspace.
Right now, I don't have a workspace loaded, but if you want to import a workspace, this is how you would do it. For this particular session, I started with a default workspace. You know, I wanted to start with Painter default when I built the brush that I was showing how to build. So without other custom changes made, so I started with a default workspace and just had my brush control panels and so on open so we could get right to work. But this is how you would import the workspace right here. Now, with the workspace that I use, I typically use custom palette like this. If I'm in building brushes mode, then of course I'll have my brush controls open that you have right here. But if not, I'll have these closed. I'll have my canvas mounted like so, and I'll have my navigator and my color panels accessible. I'm really glad you asked that question because I use the mixer a lot, and I use custom mixers, and I also use custom color set libraries, which I don't have loaded right now because, like I said, I wanted to start with the default. So when I do my colors, actually in one of our meetings not too long ago, someone said, well, if you don't start with a photo, how do you get your colors? Well, I mix them the way an artist would mix them on an artist palette like so, and then choosing another color right here and applying it. Right now, dirty brush mode is turned on. Now we have apply color. And then this is the mix color tool. So for this particular piece right here, I wanted a mixture of warm colors and cool colors. So I started a new mixer pad. And I applied colors, and I can just come over here and choose the sample color. There we go. And then I could apply it. And then I used my color panel, and I mixed oranges like so. And then for my blues, I'm going to choose my sample color, and I'm going to just sample from my image right here, and then apply, and then I just change my color panel like this, and this is how I mix my colors. So I'll plan a color palette like that. I love to use color. You know, I paint a lot of California seascapes and landscapes. And our color here can be, it's almost like subtropical desert. And I like my colors to be a little bit more vivid than they are in nature here. So what I'll do is I'll look at what we have in nature, and then I'll just do a little bit brighter or a little bit more saturation to it. So it still has some realism to it, but it has a little bit more punch. I like to use complementary colors, you know, say that you see the peaches that are in the clouds here, you know, with the sky blue behind and also the blue of the water. So it's kind of like a subtle complementary color situation. And then I typically will make a mixer and a color set for a series. So if I'm doing a series, so if I was going to do more paintings of this area, in Australia from my memories and references, I would create a custom mixer and custom color set to hold those colors. That way I could go there and I could choose my colors easily. That's a little brighter. And we can mix them like so. So with Painter's wonderful mixer panel and color panel, we can create just about any color we can imagine, from realistic color to color that's just out of this world.
Very nice.
Well, thank you so much. It's been an honor to be here with you and everyone, and I really appreciate you organizing this, Tanya, and thinking of me, and thank you everyone for coming. It's been a pleasure.